side as well. So just in the way of process, we're going to hear from John, who is the primary numbers cruncher report author, to talk about the details and the incredible spike we've seen in child poverty in Alberta. And then Laurie is going to speak, and then I'm going to wrap up and bring it back to sort of the political challenges that we have. And then we're just going to open it up for one-on-ones for interviews with any of us, as well as the parents, and move forward from there. So the formal part should only take about 10 minutes or so. So I also just want to ask the media, I actually shouldn't have to, I know you guys know this stuff, but obviously people who are living in poverty or challenged, who've never been spoken in the media before, it's very nerve-wracking for them. So just, you know, be respectful of what they're willing to say or not say as you're interviewing them. But it's so wonderful to have some moms who have been able to come forward here. Don is with the hat there. Alec is willing to speak. And Nikolai, I think, is in the back with the kids there, as well as one of the moms willing to speak as well. So, but afterwards, we'll connect you up with them. Yeah, Amy's here, but not, she's too nervous to speak, so, and that's totally fine. We totally respect that, so, but I'm glad you're here. Okay, so please welcome John Kolkman from the Edmonton Social Plan.
Thanks, Bill. And I'm just going to spend a few minutes going through some of the highlights of the In This Together report. And pages 2 to 5 of the report contain information on recent trends that are impacting low-income families with children in Alberta. Chart 2 shows that in 2009, the most recent year for which data is available, 73,000 children, 1 in 11, lived in poverty. This is a 40% increase from the previous year, as Bill mentioned. 34,000 of these children were 6 years or younger. In other words, 1 in 8 younger children lived in poverty. Chart 3 shows that the recent recession caused poverty rates in two-parent families to more than double, from 3.4% in 2007 to 8% in 2009. Chart 4 shows that almost half of these children living in poverty were from families where those in the household worked at least the equivalent of full-time for the full year. Charts 5 and 6 show that income inequality is growing in Alberta. 20 years ago, Alberta was a province with low inequality. Today, our province has medium inequality. Alberta's economy is lifting the yachts much faster than the canoes. 1 in 4 employed Albertans work for low wages, which we define as less than $15 per hour. And of those low-wage workers, Chart 7 shows that 56% of them are older adults, 25 years and over. Chart 8 shows that the recession hit vulnerable Albertans hard, including Aboriginal people and young people. And despite the economic recovery so far in 2011, unemployment rates for these vulnerable groups remain well above pre-recession levels. Charts 9, 10, and 11 show the huge jump in EI beneficiaries, social assistance caseloads, and food bank use during the recent recession. EI claims peaked in 2009, and social assistance caseloads and food bank use peaked a year later in 2010. Finally, Chart 12 shows that income transfer programs, such as child tax benefits, social assistance, and employment insurance, can reduce child and family poverty. And in the absence of these transfers, there would have been 44% more children living in poverty than there were as a result of families receiving these transfers. And so pages 6 to 10 of the report outline solutions that will make a meaningful difference. And many of these solutions involve improving upon what we already know is working well. And these solutions include enhancing federal child tax benefits, introducing a parallel Alberta child benefit, rewarding work by increasing the minimum wage and employment tax credits and implementing a living wage for government contracted services, increasing and indexing income support, such as Alberta Work, for those who can't work, and then strengthening public services like childcare, early childhood development, education, health care, and public pensions. Delivering on the province's 10-year homeless plan, and then most importantly, adopting a comprehensive approach to poverty reduction. So that's the report in a few short minutes, and I'll turn it over to Lori.
Good morning. Alberta's over 6,000 registered social workers are advocates for fairness, social justice, and social policies that serve and protect the public interest. We are pleased today to join with Public Interest Alberta and the Edmonton Social Planning Council to inform Albertans of this important research. I will highlight three key findings of the research: overrepresentation of women living in poverty, increasing inequality amongst Albertans, and inadequate resources for vulnerable and marginalized families. As John said, child poverty has increased dramatically in Alberta, according to most recent statistics. Obviously, children are not living in poverty by themselves. They live with their families. We know the face of poverty is predominantly female. Women are more likely to be poor than men due to many unique social factors. Women are caregivers for children, seniors, and those that are ill. Women have higher representation in the low-wage earner category and only earn 66% of what men earn in Alberta. Over two-thirds of low-wage workers 25 years and older are women. Many more women than men work in low-wage occupations. In addition, many women are employed as servers, and thus women are disproportionately impacted by the Alberta government's decision to implement a lower two-tiered minimum wage for these workers. Female-headed lone parent families have doubled the rate of poverty compared to two-parent families. Increasing inequality. In the last 20 years, disparities amongst families are growing in Alberta. The top 10% of families are taking an ever-increasing share, with the middle and lower income families only receiving marginal increases. Many families are compensating for this by working longer hours. Workers in Alberta work the longest hours compared to the rest of Canada. This leads to further stresses on the family due to lack of time for leisure activities, time to care for their children, and involvement in the community. Our statistics show currently Alberta has medium inequality, as John said. Previously, we had low inequality. Society's higher rates of inequality have many more social ills than those that are more equal. We're moving in the wrong direction in Alberta. The government of Alberta helps to reduce poverty through income support programs, tax credits, public services like childcare, education, and health care. In the absence of government support, many more people would be living in poverty. However, not enough is being done. Social service funding has never recovered from the deep cuts made in the 90s. Social workers and human service workers have unmanageable caseloads and not enough resources to support vulnerable citizens. There are solutions to this. We can end poverty in Alberta. We need a comprehensive plan to prevent, reduce, and ultimately eliminate poverty. In a rich province such as ours, children and their families should not be living in poverty. There are many ways, as our report details, that governments can support vulnerable children and their families. Recently, Premier Redford has identified as the number one objective for Dave Hancock, the Minister of Human Services, is to develop a comprehensive social policy framework for Alberta. We urge the Minister to work with us to develop this framework for Albertans. We would like to be part of the process. We all benefit when the most vulnerable in our society are cared for. We all benefit when social justice principles are followed. Let's work together to end poverty in Alberta.
Well, thank you, Laurie. I think for all Albertans and for our provincial government, this report should be
a very serious wake-up call. 73,000 children living in poverty in such a wealthy province as Alberta. We can do better. As we've heard, there are a number of solutions. There are things that can be done out there. But what's lacking in this province right now is the fundamental political will. We were pleased, and we put part of a quote that we got from Premier Redford, or before she became Premier Redford, about her commitment to trying to establish a comprehensive poverty reduction strategy. So we're hopeful at this stage that we're going to see some more than just talk. We've seen in the past a lot of talk, a lot of rhetoric around what we do. And yes, we recognize in this report that there are things that are being done, very important things that are being done. But when we see going in the opposite direction, when we see a 40% increase in the child poverty rate, we know that we can't just sit back and say, oh, the economy will do it. Yes, we have a very strong economy, but there is so much more that we have to do. And we have to do it in an integrated way. It's not just one ministry. It's not just the Ministry of Human Services, Dave Hancock, that has to be involved with it. We have to look to education. We have to look to seniors care. We have to look to employment and immigration. All of these things work together, our health care. And at the end of the day, we are all in this together, because if we can reduce and prevent and ultimately eliminate poverty, it will be good for our economy, it will strengthen our communities, and we can live in this province and be very proud of that commitment that we're pushing for. Six other provinces already have comprehensive poverty reduction strategies. There's another one in the process, the Yukon Territory. Or all the territories are in the process of consulting with their population about what can we do collectively together. Alberta needs to start that process, and we really want to see some movement before the next provincial election as to what this government is proposing to do. Okay? So I think with that, we will open it up. As I mentioned before, Dawn is here shortly, so... Nikolai in the back with the kids and Alice are here for people to interview, as well as the folks from the Head Start program. And then John, Laurie, and I are available. Rather than do a formal Q&A, I know you guys need some more one-on-one stuff, so if that's good. Thank you so much for coming all the way out to La Pearl. Thanks again to La Pearl ABC Head Start for hosting this. And we'll just hang out here, and we're at your disposal. Thank